This is Clinton Callahan with Next Culture News. We're talking to Donald McLaughlin here in Sydney, Australia. He's going to talk about a new idea, concept for sustainable economy. Donald.
Four assumptions. That the driver of unsustainability, the primary driver in a practical sense, is overconsumption globally. That the primary driver of overconsumption is status envy, or this notion of progress which is tied in with greater progression equals greater consumption or materialism as we understand it. Third assumption, that this status envy is primarily driven by financial inequity. And the fourth assumption is that this financial inequity is actually the pinpoint that we need to target if we're actually looking to developing sustainable economies, especially in a macro sense. So if we take financial inequity as the fundamental, one of the fundamental base points of the reason that we're in so much trouble, despite so many wonderful things happening around the world in isolation, some of them in connection, then we need essentially an economics that actually looks to redress financial inequity. Now, most people would turn around and say, well, capitalism can do that. But capitalism can't do that, primarily because if you had a form of capitalism that actually ensured relative levels of financial equity within a system, then you would lose all the incentive for innovation, because that redistribution would have to come from probably two different things. The first would be taxation, and the second would be welfare, philanthropy. Now, any system in the past that I've ever encountered that has tried to create financial equity through a redistribution, through taxation or philanthropy, has ultimately hit hurdles that hasn't allowed it to continue. Or if it has, hasn't redistributed enough to ensure there isn't a rising drift between the poorest and the richest. In financial terms. The model I'm working on is grounded in an alternative form of business that has actually existed historically longer than any other form of business. It's not-for-profit business. And years ago, what changed my understanding in this space was I went to a conference in Australia and a man got up and he spoke about his engineering company called Myuma. And he told us how it had 50 staff, a turnover of $17 million a year, was doing civil and construction engineering in outback Australia. And then he said, and we're not for profit. And I was like, what? I went up to him, talked to him afterwards and said, what do you mean? He said, well, we're set up legally as a not for profit, which doesn't mean we can't make profits. We make plenty of profits. It just means we can't redistribute them to individuals or shareholders. We don't have shareholders. No one owns the company. We have a committee of management and we have our staff and we pay good wages. And any surplus that we make is redistributed according to the objects within our constitution, which actually means we can give money to other groups philanthropically, or we can put into the next year's budget for a raise in staff salaries, all sorts of things. But no individuals are gaining private profit from this. And this set me on a really interesting journey, because I was running an organisation in Australia that helps people in the not-for-profit space. And we had simultaneously the emergence of social enterprise around the world, this notion that enterprises, to wean themselves off the financial instability that comes with the boom and bust cycles of capitalism, and to wean themselves off dependency towards philanthropy or government funding, etc., one of the best ways to do that is to actually engage in enterprise. And so the world's biggest, this isn't anything new by the way, the world's biggest not-for-profit, BRAC, employs 110,000 people, reaches 10 million people a year with its health services, education, all sorts of services, is based out of Bangladesh and is a not-for-profit. And it's a not-for-profit where 80% of its income actually comes from enterprises. So they run bakeries, they have craft stores, a chain of craft stores. They had a publishing house, I think, at one point. And this is interesting because not many people would A, know what the world's biggest not-for-profit is, or B, think that the world's biggest not-for-profit would be almost financially independent. And this is where the game is changing. Because within a not-for-profit space, you actually have the seed of the potential to do innovation while simultaneously allowing for a redistribution of wealth or an adequate distribution of wealth. But the trick here in comparison to other ideas that have been put forward in the past is two things. Firstly, that not-for-profits can be innovative. So most people, when they think about redistribution, maybe they think about communism or they think about various forms of socialism, etc. And there's often not the drive for enterprise associated with that. Well, the game's changing in that space for a number of reasons. If you look at what happened, is happening in Europe with high levels of unemployment among young people in particular, they're shifting into the peer-to-peer production space, where they're actually working collaboratively, not for money often, although there's some benefits associated with their own lives in terms of products that they might receive out of this space. Largely, this is the heralding of the reputation economy, where we see a shift from financial gain, which is linked so closely in many senses to consumption and overconsumption. We see that shift as the pinnacle for the drive, the motivation for engagement in enterprise, to one of reputation economy, where people do things because they're put up on a pedestal, because they get known to be the coder who contributed that wonderful line of code, for example. And this is the start, or is the continuation of the changing of the game in this space. And where this is particularly interesting is that you're starting now to see not-for-profits for a whole host of reasons, because there's lower startup costs associated with some not-for-profits because they get the ability to engage with volunteers. This is across many countries in different forms, whether you call it non-profit in the US, not-for-profit in Australia. Actually having the ability to engage with volunteers, to get discounted software, tax concessions, all sorts of things. We're starting to see, with the inclusion of enterprise in this space, the potential for for-profits to be outcompeted by not-for-profits in the next 30, 40, 50 years. So it's not just that not-for-profit is something that morally works in terms of redistribution of wealth, the maintenance of innovation from a social innovation perspective, given that not-for-profits have to be driven fundamentally by the provision or fulfillment of social need. So you're getting things done, which are hopefully things that people agree need to be done. So that increases. But at the same time, you're actually seeing the inevitability of the end of the for-profit business model, because it's going to be outcompeted by not-for-profits. Not only because of the gains associated with being not-for-profit, but because of falling profit margins in the for-profit space over the last 30, 40 years, because of what peak resources are going to do in terms of putting pressure on those profit margins. And because there's a fundamental shift in consciousness that is continuing to evolve that understands the provision of private profit, especially on a macro level, as ultimately unethical or dysfunctional is more the language that I would use. It's not functional for things to continually be privatized, including profit. This ties into the debates around ownership of property, ownership of companies, etc., etc. And so this fits in, I think, quite well with the next culture thinking around the unification of divine masculine, divine feminine, the shift from patriarchy into some form of divine union, the initiation that's involved in that process, the ongoing processes in that space. And so as late as it is at night and as lightheaded as I am, that's just a little bit of an insight into some of the ideas that I'm working with the Post-Growth Institute to develop a not-for-profit world by 2050 based in not-for-profit enterprise that I think is not only necessary, I think it can be sustainable at a micro and a macro level. I think, more importantly than perhaps anything, given the history of people putting out pipe dreams, I think what's interesting about this model is that we're claiming it's actually inevitable. And so the call to action then, once our book hopefully comes out later this year, the call to action is more one of how do we accelerate that inevitability and ensure that we don't have the equivalent of great depressions associated with a transition to a new economics that draws on existing spheres of wisdom from all around the world already, such that it's a model that evolves rather than something that we transition to in a new paradigm space.
Give us the book title, the website name.
The book's tentatively called How on Earth, Flourishing in a Not-for-Profit World by 2050.
And your present contact information for people that get in touch with you now?
Just go to postgrowth.org and you can contact myself or my colleagues that way.
How do you spell your last name?
McClurkin, M-A-C-L-U-R-C-A-N, and Donnie McClurkin.
Donald, thanks for talking to us tonight. This is Next Culture News. Clinton Callahan checking out from Sydney, Australia. Isn't that cool? I'm asking anyone for help. God, oh man, I don't care. Just a little.